Hi all, this is Dr. O, and we're going to move back into a little bit of osteology to cover the pterygoid plates and the hamulus. So specifically, what are the pterygoid plates, which muscles attach here, and what function does the pterygoid hamulus serve? So let's start here with the lateral pterygoid plate. This is something that might be a little bit more familiar as we've talked about it with the medial and lateral pterygoid muscle attachments. So we see here on this image that lateral surface is where we find the attachment of lateral pterygoid muscle on the lateral pterygoid plate. This is also a boundary for the infratemporal fossa. So you can imagine the space lateral to this being that infratemporal fossa. Now the medial surface of the lateral pterygoid plate over here in green is the attachment for medial pterygoid muscle. It's also part of this pterygoid fossa, which is kind of this indentation we see between the lateral pterygoid plate and the medial pterygoid plate. So the medial pterygoid plate is longer, and we also see that it's associated with the pharynx. So here is our maxilla and the hard palate and the palatine portion of the hard palate that we can see into our nasal cavity, and then this space that's coming out toward us is the pharynx. The pterygoid plate is an attachment point for the superior pharyngeal constrictor. Now the process, kind of this portion right here, that extends inferiorly from the medial pterygoid plate is called the pterygoid hamulus. Now this acts as an attachment point for the pterygomandibular FA, which is a condensation of pharyngobasilar fascia, and it acts as a pulley for the tensor velae palatini muscle and its tendon. So the tensor velae palatini muscle will sit about here, and then its tendon will run medially toward the palatine aponeurosis. So this kind of sharp angle is as that muscle wraps around the pterygoid hamulus. So we'll see more about the muscles of the palate in a future session, but keep in mind that pterygoid hamulus when we're moving forward into that region. Here we're going to start with just an isolated sphenoid bone. And I want to note, here's the lesser wing, the greater wings down there. We also see the optic canals and the hypophyseal fossa here. So we're kind of looking at it as we've seen it from the cranial cavity. Now we're going to turn it a little bit, and now we're seeing kind of a posterior view of it. So here, projecting inferiorly, are those pterygoid plates. In blue, we see outlined the lateral surface of the lateral pterygoid plate, and then in green, the medial surface of the lateral pterygoid plate. Here in pink, we see is the projection of this longer medial pterygoid plate. Projecting down is the pterygoid hamulus. Now, in the context with the rest of the skull, we can see where these sit in relation to the area of the infratemporal fossa. Remember that lateral plate is the medial boundary of it, and kind of the region of the nasal cavity in the pharynx back here, where then this would continue down. All right, so let's do a little bit of review and ask now, which muscle attaches to the medial pterygoid plate? Is it the medial pterygoid muscle, the lateral pterygoid muscle, or the superior pharyngeal constrictor muscle? So take a second, choose your answer. And when you're ready, what did you say? So the correct answer here is a superior pharyngeal constrictor. So when we hear medial pterygoid plate, we're not thinking about those pterygoid muscles. the medial surface of the lateral pterygoid plate is where the medial pterygoid muscle attaches, and then the lateral surface of the lateral pterygoid plate is where the lateral pterygoid muscle attaches. Now, this medial pterygoid plate serves as an attachment for the superior pharyngeal constrictor. Keep in mind, the lateral pterygoid plate is more so associated with the infratemporal fossa, whereas the medial is more associated with the pharynx. So, great job. Thank you so much for your attention, and I will see you in the next video.